Today, I'm going to talk about a rolling disc that rolls down on a wedge, and the wedge itself can also move on this frictionless surface. So the disc is rolling and is not slipping. So that's one thing we have to remember, and there's no friction here, as I stated before. Yeah, so I'm going to use the Lagrangian method to solve this. So let's take a look at what type of generalized coordinates we can define. And I already indicated them. So there are two generalized coordinates. The wedge has a coordinate x2, which is moving in that direction. And for reference, x direction here is positive and y is downwards to be positive. So the wedge is moving in that direction, and that's what we assume initially, with generalized parameter x2. And then there is an x1 generalized parameter taken from here, and that's moving the disc so that the disc can roll down. So it's not sliding, it's rolling, and it will move in that direction. There are no generalized forces here. The generalized forces are zero. There are no non-conservative forces of any kind. There are no springs, there are no with resistance or anything like that. So the generalized forces are zero. So that makes the Lagrangian quite a bit easier. So let's now take a look at the Lagrangian itself. The Lagrangian is always the sum of the kinetic energy minus the potential energy. Yeah, and for reference, if you have a disk that rotates, the moment of inertia is half mr squared, and the rotating disk omega is equal to v over r, and we need those later, so I wrote them down. Now, what is the speed? Because we have to calculate the kinetic energy of the disk, and we start with the disk. The speed of the disk is a combination of the speed here and the speed here. Yeah, so x1 you can take in two directions, in the x and the y direction, which is x1 cosine theta and x2 sine theta, and they're both positive because y is taken positive going downward. So if you have here the x, which x1, the generalized coordinate, which directs in this direction, you will have x1 cosine theta, that piece, for the x coordinate, and x2 sine theta, that piece, in the y direction. For x2, you only have something in the x direction, so that's x2 0. Okay? So now the disk has a kinetic energy of half mv squared, and the speed is essentially split up in two pieces. There is a rotating part, a half I omega squared from the rotational kinetic energy, and there's a translational part here. And the translational part is essentially, as I stated before, the sum of these two speeds. So you have x1 dot plus x2 dot squared. That's the half mv squared there. And then the rotating one, you take I from a half mr squared from a rotating disk, and omega is phi over r, and phi is essentially the speed of x1. So if you fill that all out, you get a half m x1 dot squared plus a half m x2 dot squared, working this one out, plus a cross product, yeah, 2 times x1 dot x2 times the half here, which gives you m x1 dot x2 dot cosine theta. And then when you work this one out by inserting I and omega, so into this one, you get a half mx1 dot squared. So adding it all up, simplifying it a little bit, you get 3/4 mx1 dot squared plus a half mx2 dot squared plus mx1 dot x2 dot cosine theta. So this is the kinetic energy of the disk, all the components included. So now we're going to look at the kinetic energy of the wedge, because the wedge is also moving. That's a half mv2 squared. And that's very easy because it's only moving in that one x direction, so you get a half m0 x2 dot squared. You can add them up, and now you have the total kinetic energy of the system. Yeah, which is a half m plus m0 x2 dot squared, etc. So that's the total kinetic energy of the system, both wedges, both the wedge and the disc. Now we need to take a look at the potential energy. Now the wedge doesn't really have potential energy because it's essentially resting on this surface, frictionless surface, but the disc definitely does have. Now I took some sort of virtual reference L here, which is not depicted here at all, but it doesn't matter because it's a constant. It's just where you put your potential energy zero point. What is important though is that if you roll down, the potential energy decreases, and that's why there's a minus sign here. And the potential energy decreases by mg x1 sine theta. Yeah, and that's quite easy to see because you have your triangle essentially, and it's the vertical height that's being reduced, which is a sine. So you can rewrite that and you get this. Now we can essentially generate a Lagrangian, which was T minus V, because this potential is the only potential component there is nothing else, and we get the Lagrangian over here. Now this Lagrangian you can obviously solve with the Lagrange equation, which I've given here. The right hand side are all zeros because there are no non-conservative forces, like we stated before, and this just needs to be worked out. For reference, I also rewrote the Lagrangian again to make sure that we know what we're working on. So let's start with differentiating it towards x1 dot. So the Lagrangian will be differentiated towards x1 dot. You get 3 2, because 6 4th, right? So it's 3 2 times m times x1 dot. And you differentiate that towards time, so you get the x1 double dot here. Here's another term that includes x1 dot. So you differentiate that to x1 dot and you get mx2 dot cosine theta. You have to differentiate that again to t, so you get an x2 double dot. And now you have to subtract the Lagrangian differentiated towards x1. So if you do that, this is a plus mg x1 sine theta. You differentiate that towards m1. This is a plus. You have to hear a minus, so you have to state a minus here, minus mg sine theta, and that equals zero. So this is our first equation of motion. You do the same for x2 dot, differentiating towards x2, start again with the Lagrangian. You differentiate the first term, and you get m plus m0 times x2 dot one time differentiated. Differentiated towards t, you get the second derivative, that's this term. And then again here, you have this term that results in mx1 double dot cosine theta equals zero. So these are the two equations of motion that describe the exact behavior on how these two objects are going to move. Now I wrote them down again for reference. And if you look carefully now, these are fairly simple equations. It's essentially two equations with two unknowns. And what are the unknowns? The first one is the x1 double dot, and the second one is the x2 double dot. And these are two unknowns with two variables. There are no dependencies in x1 single dot or x2 single dot, so you can easily eliminate them using standard algebraic techniques. And your result will be that x1 double dot, which is the acceleration of the disk, is equal to this. Yeah, and we call this alpha 1 for reference. We need that later. And x2, you do the same. You just solve it and you get this, which we call alpha 2. Now let me make a few comments on this. First of all, this is a constant, right? Because sine theta is a constant angle here. The masses are constant. M and M0 are both constant. G, the gravity, is constant also, it's about 10. So this is a constant number, and this is also a constant number, and that's what you expect. right? There are no springs in the system, there are no other interesting components or non-conservative forces in the system. So you would expect a constant acceleration, and that's what we got. The second thing you can see is that if you look very carefully at the first one, for instance, that the denominator here is negative because g is positive, m's are always positive, and sine theta is also positive because the angle is smaller than pi over 2, so this is also positive. So this gives you a negative denominator because of the minus sign here. The denominator here, let's take a look at that. Cosine theta is again smaller than pi over 2. So this number here could only be up to 1. That varies between 0 and 1 here. So you have plus 2m here and minus 3m here. So that's a minus m, right? And you subtract on top of that minus 3m0. So this will be a negative number always. The denominator will always be negative. So x1 double dot here, since the numerator is negative and the denominator is negative, will be positive. So you will have a positive acceleration in that direction. Now let's take a look at x2. Again, as before, this one is negative, always. This one, again, is positive because theta is smaller than pi over 2. So cos pi over 2 is positive, sine also. So this is a positive number, negative number, gives you a total negative number, so your acceleration is negative. So we assumed that the acceleration would go this way, but the formula here says that it's going the other way. And that makes total sense, because this rolling disk is essentially pushing the wedge in that direction. So it gets a negative. So we could have assumed initially that this was going the other way, and then you would have a positive also here, but we didn't, and therefore that's a negative. So that works out great. And again, since there are no active other things there, you would expect a constant acceleration. So now we can integrate those two times. I call this alpha 1, otherwise it becomes a little cumbersome and big in formula. And I call this one alpha 2. So you can integrate them twice, right, because it's an x1 double dot, and you get your generic solution, how the position varies over time. If you would assume, for instance, that you have an initial location of 0 and an initial speed of 0, then beta 1 gamma 1 and beta 2 gamma 2 will all be 0, and you just get a half alpha 1 t squared, and that's exactly what you expect. As a last comment, let's take a look at when theta is pi over 2. That would be an interesting one, right? Because what you would expect is probably that the wedge is not going to move, and you would probably expect some sort of acceleration, because this one is then all vertical of this disk going downwards. Will it be g? Will it be less? Let's see what happens. So if we do pi over 2, this one will be 1, this one will be 0. You can remove those two, and you see that the acceleration is g over 3 and not g, what you normally have if you drop something. Why is that, you think? Well, the reduction in acceleration is due to the fact that this one needs to be spun up. Remember, this one is not slipping, so you cannot really slip. It's rotating. And because it's rotating, your acceleration will not be g, it will be less than that. And that's what we see here. On the acceleration of x2 on the 90 degrees, we can already see that cosine of pi over 2 equals 0, so the acceleration will be 0. So in that case, your wedge will remain static and nothing will happen, and that's exactly what you expect. Okay, I think this is a great place to stop. If you like this video, please like and please subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.